you know, Sundays also. Great. Okay, so welcome you all on the second session of the same day, and we will focus on to the the very important aspect, that is analysis. And I'll give you the different types of stuff that we can actually do it and use it in your day-to-day life. So again, what I'm going to do is we'll have a very quick small case study, okay? And what I am going to do is this case study, if you can see on the screen, all right? So maybe you all can click it on your photograph also, and just I'll read out to all of you. After this, we'll go into a breakout room, and you have to come up with the answers with the set of questions which I'm going to share. So the case goes like this. Regional hospital is a 500 bed hospital and several associated clinics in a major East Coast metropolitan area. It has been an aggressive adopter of computing technologies in efforts to decrease cost and improve operational efficiencies. The critical challenge facing the hospital is meeting its ongoing challenges to the staff, hospital, and allied clinic effectively, given the ongoing shortage of nurses. Uncertainty in the healthcare legislation, emphasis on shortening hospital stay to reduce cost, which caused the daily census, which is number of patients in various departments, to vary dramatically from day to day and shift to shift. The continued aging of the population is in primary care area, and the unending competition of employees with key skill set. Employees' expense represents more than 80% of the overall cost of operations to the hospital. So identifying way to match optimal skills and number of employees to the appropriate shift to critical to achieve consistent success. However, individual shift manager struggles to make effective staffing decision, resulting in consistent overstaffing or understaffing of shifts and department. These staffing problems potentially increase high cost of varied level of patient care and satisfaction, and potentially increases the risk that staff over may escalate because of dissatisfaction with the continuing inability of managers to match staffing demands to need. Company managers recognizes the potential that HR matrix and analytics might have for their organization, and they have come to you for help. Okay, so they are hearing from their peers in the hospital that matrix can help in this area, but not they're not quite sure where to start. They are looking for you to offer a guidance on how to do HR matrix and workforce analytics. I hope the case is clear. If you want, you can click this case study on your WhatsApp or in an image. Okay, and what question you have to answer now? Do you believe that a program of HR matrix and work analytics might be useful in regional hospital? If so, why? What opportunities do you see regarding where and how matrix and analytics might be applied in this organization? You need to identify three analyses, as per your thought process. Associate metrics you think might be useful for regional hospital consider. How might regional hospital utilize benchmarking as a part of its metrics and analytics efforts, if at all? What advice would you offer to the manager at regional hospital about developing a program of HR metrics and workforce analytics? And what potential problem might occur in the establishment of HR metrics and workflows analytics program for RH managers, about which you would want to alert them prior to the beginning of this project? So you can again click this, you know, the questions. And now I would request, kindly, sir, please put them in a breakout rooms. We are a good.
So, Andrila, who has been noting in our group?
Yeah, Saurabh, I think.
Saurabh, would you like?
No, Rajdeep was making a note.
I was making the notes. Yes.
So, Rajdeep, will you please call then?
Yeah, sure. Let me. Yeah, shall I read out whatever we have discussed?
Yeah. Just share my screen also so that it's good for all of you.
Right. Yeah, perfect. Yeah. So the first question says, do you believe that a program of HR metrics and workforce analysis might be useful in regional hospital? If so, why? Whatever we discussed, we decided that yes, a program of HR metrics and workforce analysis will be useful, because whatever we have read from the case study, we understood that an HR metrics and workforce analysis will be useful to ensure proper decision making, to ensure productivity, effective management, that is effective talent management, skill matching according to the specific skills required or something, and overstaffing and understaffing. So we need to find out if there is any overstaffing in a particular department and if there's any understaffing in a particular department. So this is what we have decided.
Perfect.
Okay, excellent. Okay, so the next question reads, what opportunities do you see regarding where and how metrics and analytics might be applied in this organization? So, the first thing that caught our attention was we read that employee expenses represent more than 80%. So, I think we think that that needs to be monitored and that needs to be taken care of. So, basically, cost to hire, cost to retain, cost to train, all these things have to be taken into account while we study this, while we make a case study of this particular case. Manpower planning, effective compensation, and also attracting young talent, because if we read the case in the particular case study, one particular point was made that a lot of employees are aging. So I think in the primary care sector or something. So naturally, attracting young talent will also be also needs to be taken care of. So basically, in a nutshell, effective succession management has to be implemented in the organization.
Okay.
So coming to the third point, it says identify three analyses and associated metrics. So the three analyses that we have decided that needs to be taken care of are, number one, skill gap analysis. Okay. Number two, workforce gap analysis, and number three, training of the shift managers. Because in the case study, it was written that, I mean, right now, me actually. So it was written somewhere that the shift managers, they have some difficulties. They face some difficulties while allotting duties to the nursing staff or something. So their training has to be ensured so as to remove this gap. So these are the three analyses that we have decided. Yeah, and metrics we could not decide because we ran out of time. So that's it. So till question number three, part of question number three, we have discussed. Sorry.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. So till question number three, we could discuss, because after that
after that you could not. No problem. Let's hear the other group members, please.
Right. Yes.
So for us, the major need for matrices was for optimization of workforce. Also regarding how could we ensure that the workforce had sufficient skill sets so that there was no issue of, there were issues in shortage of nurses being in staff. So we feel that yes, workforce analytics and HR matrices should be in place. Mm-hmm. And it's analysis primarily on training, optimization of work, also maintaining record of the patients who are being sort of who are there in the history of it, so that trend analysis can also be conducted regarding the same.
Okay.
So that's regarding the first question. Others can also share if I have missed out anything.
So Neha, you've become the showstopper for the group. So I think you continue, no
problem. Okay. So regarding the second question, what opportunity do you see regarding where and how matrices and analytics might be applied in this organization? So definitely the focus should be regarding optimization of workforce. So we will be looking at manpower planning, looking at booster as in terms of attendance. Staffing would also lead to recruitment, because we feel somewhere we would definitely need additional staff, and training who are existing in the system would be essential, because we see a lot of challenges that are happening in terms of shifts being underutilized, and issues in employees being given.
I lost your voice, Neha.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, now you're audible. Thank you.
Yeah. So last but not least, attracting talent, so that in future this particular problem does not arise. So proper succession planning and career planning is taken care of. Additionally, to sustain and retain the workforce that's there, IDPs can also be thought of as to how the employees can grow in the longer process. So not going overboard anywhere. So this is regarding the second question. Third one we discussed primarily regarding, one was towards staffing. Second was towards inflow of patients and aging of patients. So what is the kind of age, the gender, who are there for a longer time, what are the kind of diseases that they have. So based record of patients, also training would be essentially important for as an matrize, because there is a lot of issue regarding shift managers being not really sure what to do and, you know, conduct and carry that particular shift properly. Second would be towards the skill gap analysis and having a proper skill matrix in place. So that is regarding the third question. Fourth question, unfortunately, we could only cover partially. So I think I would rest at only question number three.
No problem. Okay, so if I have to ask any group members, if you would like to answer question number six. What potential problem might occur in the establishment of HR matrix analytics?
And there might be resistance from the employees. That might be the first hurdle.
That would be probably the biggest hurdle, because people don't want to see their name in the matrix. They don't want to be calculated on their conduct. So that's the difficult buying in. So, great insight you all have given. Nice thought, nice perspective. This is how actually we do it. But now these, whatever we talked about right now is focusing on the questions and your, past experience and your certain set of analogies that you've shared. But then the most important here is there is no right and wrong answer till the time we work with the numbers. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to touch upon the very important aspect of the HR analysis that we need to do. Now, the moment we talk about HR analysis, so the very first thing, let me give you an aspect, because a lot of people are not knowing what to use or what not to use. Okay. So does anyone know the difference between arithmetic mean, geometric mean, and harmonic mean? Okay, what is mean? Let us try and understand.
Average.
Average. Superb. Okay. Now, let's say I'll give you one situation and one scenario. Okay. So suppose there is Rajdeep. He's standing outside one. So he's near one pond. Ek talab ke paas Rajdeep khada hua hai. And he doesn't know what's the depth of that particular pond. And he doesn't know swimming. So what he does is he starts getting an input from the people just to know that what is the depth of this particular pond. Okay. So he asks people. So he asks the first member, can anyone tell me iski kitni gehrai hai? What is the depth? So Andrila says only 1 feet. Okay. I says, oh, 1 feet, no problem. Rajdeep says 2 feet. Alka says 2 feet. Andita says 3 feet, Kumkum says 5 feet, Neelam says 1 feet, Neha says 2 feet, Prabodh says 3 feet, Saurabh says 21 feet. Okay? And Shyamlal again says 2 feet. Now, if you will take out the average, logically, the 13 people right now, if you have, your average will come, the mean will come to 2 or 3 as an answer. Isn't it? Now, very smartly, Rajdeep thinks, oh, there's hardly any depth. Let me take a jump. And he jumped where it is 21 feet. Now, what will happen to Rajdeep? So, he will be drawn. Wo doob jayega. Kyunki usko swimming to aati nahi hai. So, ladies and gentlemen, the most important thing in the analysis aspect, one is that we have to work on range, maximum minus minimum. So maximum was 21 feet and the minimum was 1 feet. Okay. So that is the one. So that means the range is 20 feet. So the best analysis works when you work both on mean and range. That's the first thing. Now, when we talk about, arithmetic mean, definitely it is nothing but when you add all the numbers and divide it by the total number of observations. And I've given one example of 4 plus 10 plus 7 is equal to 21 by 3. So the mean is 7. Whereas the geometric mean is a multiplicative relationship where the data gets compounded and you will find the data is not linear and you will get a very accurate of the mean. Okay. Then there is another which is called harmonic mean, which is used when we want to average units such as speed, rates, and ratios. So we should be knowing what mean to use. And as per my experience, people don't know which mean to use. Now, I can see one question coming up. Ek minute, dekhti hu. Acha, abhi awaaz theek hai, Alka? Okay, so the formula is very easy. Okay, I'll give you formulas very nicely and we'll do one calculation also. So arithmetic mean, I'll not go in deep dive. How do we calculate? We all know that. Geometric mean is the... Awaaz cut hua abhi, theek hai? I've changed my... Is it fine?
Geometric mean for a given number of
values. Yes, it is.
Okay.
An observation is the nth root of the product of the
value. Yeah. So the geometric mean is given the number of values containing the nth observation in the nth root of the product of the values. And harmonic is the reciprocal of the arithmetic mean of the given data value. It, how it is represented, I will give you a very simple example. Okay. Oh, sorry. My mistake. Yeah. So guys, the formula, can you see this? Mean is A plus B plus C if there are 3 observations divided by 3. Correct? I will touch upon median and mode later. Geometric mean is if there are 3 values, A into B into C and cube root. So that's how it will become. harmonic mean is, so the number of observations are 3. So 3 divided by 1 over A, 1 over B, 1 over C. So the average is most used in any set of situations. The geometric mean is very good when I'm checking the investment growth area or a volume. And you will see the accuracy coming in. When you will see harmonic mean, when I'm checking the cost, production and speed. Specifically, when I'm calculating the cost in the HR related, which mean should I use? Harmonic, geometric or arithmetic? Anyone in the group, please use the chat box or unmute yourself.
And please repeat the question.
If I'm using the cost in an organization, HR cost, if I'm calculating, which mean will I use?
The harmonic mean, I think.
Super.
Geometric mean.
Harmonic mean.
Yeah, correct. So I have seen majorly the people doing this mistake of not knowing which mean to use. And that's why your analogy goes incorrect.
Can I ask the question in previous slide? See, in arithmetic mean or harmonic mean, of course, in harmonic, we are taking it a ratio. We are, it's summative. We are adding up the figures. Why do we multiply in geometric mean?
Because
like A into B into C, right?
Yeah. So, see, in that case, there is a very deep dive into it. There's a calculation which was given by the best of the statistician. And why do they do it? I'll not go deep dive into it, right?
Okay, and, no problem, yeah.
As an HR expert, I mean, there is a proper formula to it. It related to the HTV element with an alpha and a beta. And if I give you that, you'll say, okay, ma'am, thank you so much. Aap hame formula bata do, let it go.
Okay.
So, the simplistic manner is, the under root gives it in a very detailed approach, so that's how it goes. So let's try and understand. Okay, I'll give you one question. Please, I would request you to be ready with a pen and a paper and write down these formulas. Mathematically, geometrically. Please write down the formula. Or you can click it and keep it for yourself. Okay, can I share?
No, just a minute. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's okay now.
Suppose you have two numbers. Okay, so the observation value is two numbers, which is 4 and... Oh, sorry. I don't want to show the answer. Okay. Okay. Can you solve the answer?
4 and
9. Yeah. 4 and 9. Abhi theek hai. 4 and 9. Kindly calculate arithmetic mean, geometric mean and harmonic mean. I'm purposely giving only two observations just to make you all understand about difference between all three of them. I will put the formulas again for you.
Done.
Okay. Okay, can I hear the answer?
Sorry, I wasn't. So my question regarding geometric mean was that since there are two numbers, I have calculated square root instead of cube root. Is it fine?
Okay, I have to open the chat box and see. Okay, arithmetic mean is 6.5.
Right.
Geometric mean is 6. And harmonic mean is
5.53. Yeah.
So, Prabodh, first of all, heartiest congratulations. 5.53. And thank you so much. So, if you will see, yes, you all are correct, right? So, if you see the accuracy of the figure, okay? So, the mean, when you will use it, harmonic mean, which will give you 5.53. Whereas arithmetic mean is actually 1 point extra, which is 6.5. So you can see the difference that if we don't use, you know, the right set of means, it will be really, really difficult for all of us. So you should kindly take on this, you know, consideration, which mean to use and which one will be beneficial. Okay. Now, so I hope all three of them is clear to you. Now, let me understand from you. There was another two things here, the median and mode. Okay. Now, we all understand median is a, you know, middle sorted value. And the mode is the most popular value, which is occurring a lot of time. Okay. So if I have to show you this graph, you know, because see, in future, nobody will be playing around with numbers. Your data will be taken care by software. The beauty is that the data will actually showcase everything. So if you will see, if I show you in the whiteboard, okay, and you will find that if I have, okay, one second, I'm drawing this for the benefit of everyone. Okay. Why I am not able to draw? One second. Yeah. Okay, now these are my data points from here, then here, this here, then there is here, this here, okay. Okay, suppose my this is 0 and my this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8. अब आप मुझे ये बताइए, आपके सामने एक ग्राफ बनकर आ जाता है. Your data gives you this graph. On the, and you know, on the x-axis you have, you know, dependent variable, and y-axis you have got independent variable. ठीक है? So can you tell me where, at which point there is a mean? At which point there is a mode and which point there is a median? Suppose there in HR you are evaluating what is the age group of the people who are working in our organization. So the first one is, let's say, you know, let's take it with an experience. This is 0 to 1, you know, 1 year of experience. This one is 2 years of experience. This is 3 years of experience. 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. ठीक है? अब आपके पास ये graph बनकर आया है. आप इसको कैसे study करोगे? What will you analyze out of this graph?
So the 3 years of experience is the average, I think.
ओके यू से एवरेज मान लिया, मुझे कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, आप मुझे बाद में जस्टिफाई करना कैसे निकाला वो हम बाद में करेंगे. आई विल टेक दैट 3 इयर्स इज योर एवरेज. ठीक है,
दिस इज द मीन. मीडियन इज बेसिकली द what should I say, it would be somewhere around a little lesser than 3. So yeah.
Okay, so Neelam says in the chat box the top of the curve is median. No Neelam, you are touching to a point, but that's not median. So let us understand here. Theek hai, I'm just closing this screen. Theek hai. Now let's understand here. I'm sharing my screen and I'll make it now very easy for all of you. Okay, when we do mean median mode, so what Neelam mentioned is, if you will see here on the screen, on the left side, which is a left skew, skewness is where the tail is going. Okay, so the tip of the bell curve is called mode. That means that is the maximum occurrence of the event or the number. So in that grid which I made, jo peak point jahan pe touch ho raha hoga ho, utne zyada hi number of years of experience people are having in the organization. Okay, mean is you will see that when it is left skewed, the mode will come first on the tip. The median would be somewhere in between, is always in between. Median is always in between of mean and mode. Always remember. The moment we'll see the right graph here, the mode is here. So the next year it will be mean and median, and mean will be here. So, if this grid is from 0 to 10, you can easily make out and you can say that 80% of the people are having an experience of 8 years. You will find the average is falling around 40% or 4 years. Whereas the more, the center point, you will find the people are having a record of median, that is median. Okay, ma'am, your voice is breaking. I'm so sorry. Is it now audible for everyone?
What? Yeah, it's otherwise audible. I think Alka might be having some problem at her site, probably.
Okay. So, guys, I hope Alka you've understood. But what I'm trying to make you understand is that, you are not there to play with the numbers. You are there to analyze the numbers and the data. So, you should be knowing and picking up these cues. So, first, you should know that which, mean to use. To get the accuracy of the data. The second thing is you should be knowing the occurrence of the data, the center point of the data, and what is the mean of the data. So that's why you will find in a statistics, people tend to cover the range element instead of the mean element, right? Mm-hmm. So is this clear with everyone?
Yeah. So basically we need to first observe very minutely what is the skewness. Like if this is a normal distribution, then mean, median, mode are ranging in between.
And they all are at the center point. That will be normal distribution. Right.
Yeah. And in the left skew, you just said rightly, and right skew is again. Yeah.
Yes. So, at that time, the moment the graph is there in front of you, you will immediately see and you will say, oh, this is what is there. Occurrence itna hai, itni hamari analysis ho rahi hai, aur ye hame pata hai. I want you to understand that you all are strategic business partners. I think from that angle. So you have to see your data and read accordingly, right? Okay. So let's try and understand the correlation and scatter. That's another very important thing that we need to do. Okay. So correlation, which is also called a scatter diagram, and then the regression, which talks about the dependency of your independent variable on a dependent variable, or a dependent variable on an independent variable. So the scatter diagram actually helps you to show the relationship between the two variables, and these variables actually show the strength between these two variables, which help us to know the correlation, right? So when we do this, the scatter diagrams put things in pair, the numerical data, and the moment you will put the data and you will run in the SPSS, Minitab, even for that matter, Excel, you will see the, the things are falling in place and the reports coming in. So you should be knowing when to use the data, when there is a numerical data is available, and that too in paired number, when you know that the dependent variable may have a multiple values for each value with your independent variable, and when you're trying to determine the two variables relationship and the potential root cause of the problem. So that problem will actually help you to know the cause and effect of the things, right? Mm-hmm. So in this, very important here is, if you are talking about the population, okay, then we use Rho, which is called as P, okay? That is, we know also use it for the probability component, P value. But if you're taking out a sample, then we relate it to the R, which is called sample correlation coefficient. So if you do an analysis for your entire organization, that means entire population, I will be using p-value. But if you, let's say, take out some people from this organization, you take out a sample of it, then you will do the R calculation, right? So this is how the observation gets done. Most important here is, the relationship falls either between minus 1 to plus 1. Or iske alawa koi value aayi nahi sakti isse zyada ya isse kam. Hamesha value iske do ke beech mein rahegi. It will show the strengthening or the weakness. The more it is touching towards plus 1 or minus 1, that is how the relationship will be shown. Let's say your answer come as 0.98. That means this is highly correlated. If your answer is coming somewhere around 0.2, very minimal relationship is there between the dependent and independent. So if you will see on my screen, between x-axis and y-axis, you will see a linear relationship of when it is going on upward, it shows positive relation. When it goes downward, it says negative relation. The curvilinear relationship is on a, you know, inverse U, whereas going haywire. Okay? Now, what they say is, when these relationships are very strong to each other, can you see on the screen? Hmm. They're very much close to each other. That means there is a strong bondage, which you can view from the graph itself. This is a weak relationship. Both negative and positive, you can see. But if we want to know the, you know, the strength of it, how strongly correlated they are, that there we will see the value of, as I say, coefficient, correlation coefficient range from minus 1 to plus 1. There it shows. Okay. So when it is going down, so all we understand is when it is going down, it is a negative relationship. Mm-hmm. This is the first thing. If it is going up, that means it's a positive relationship. If it is very much correlated with each other, all the points will be very close to each other, you will see the R will be minus 1 or else R will be plus 1. Hmm. Here, it will be somewhere around 0.6, 0.7. Again, it will be on the data point, right? The more scatter between the y-axis and x-axis, you will see the relationship coming up accordingly. So, ladies and gentlemen, here, now another important thing is, we have various tests, okay, I have given you. So, this a very important screen because, you know, you will find that people have to use this and figure it out. And how do they use it? Let's understand that. There are two kind of tests that we do. One is a parametric test and one is a non-parametric test. Hum parametric test kab karte hain? When the information about the population is completely known by means of its parameter. Matlab main mere population bhi pata hai mujhe aur main apni population ka mean bhi nikal sakti hu, theek hai, jahan pe measuring instrument available hai. Non parametric otherwise kaun sa hota hai? If there is no knowledge about the population or the parameters, but still it is required to test the hypothesis of the population, okay? So there I will use non parametric. I want to know, you know, let's say a statement comes up that in ISTD, a lot of beautiful people are studying. Abhi jo beautiful ko kaise hum describe karenge? Now that will be a challenge. Now this is a hypothesis of a non-parametric. But if I say that in ISTD, mostly all people have got a work experience of more than 3 years. अभी क्या हो गया ये मेजरिंग इंस्ट्रूमेंट हो गया है ना सो देयर इट बिकम्स पैरामेट्रिक So you will find that parametric test, you know, mostly used for a hypothesis testing, ki hum log koi bhi jab statement pass karte hain, which provides the generalization, you know, for making a statement about the mean of the parent population. So they say that either we work on a one sample test or a two sample test. Okay. So whenever we take one sample, we do either a t-test or a z-test. In the last class, I did mention you when to use t-test and z-test. Who would like to share that? Hum log t-test kab use karte hain? Z-test?
30 and more than 30.
Very nice. Thank you so much. So I use t-test when the population size is less than 30. Mm-hmm. And if it is more than 30, then I use z-test. Okay? Okay, and then if there is two sample test, then either I use independent sample test or a paired sample test. Again, in independent sample test, we have a two group T test and Z test. And in a paired sample, we have a paired T test. You should be only knowing these which tests to apply where. Aap log ko ye nahi sochna hai ki isko apply kaise karna hai. Aap wo aapka software karega. That software will take care of it. Okay, so the T statistics actually rest on the underlying assumption that there is a normal distribution of the variable and the mean is either known or at least a least assumption is there. So you will find that the mean of the population or mean of the sample is very important. And a non-parametric test are also known as, they call it distribution free test. इसमें डेटा नॉर्मली डिस्ट्रीब्यूटेड शायद ना भी हो, सो दैट्स व्हाई वी कॉल इट डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन फ्री टेस्ट. दे डिफाइन दैट द हाइपोथेसिस टेस्ट व्हिच आर एक्चुअली नॉट बेस्ड ऑन अंडरलाइंग एग्जम्पशन, व्हिच इज दे से दे यू नो एक्चुअली डू नॉट रिक्वायर द पॉपुलेशन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन टू डिनोट इट बाय अ स्पेसिफिक पैरामीटर. सो दीज टेस्ट आर मेनली बेस्ड ऑन डिफरेंस इन द मीडियन. तो हम इसमें क्या करते हैं नॉन पैरामेट्रिक में, क्योंकि मीन तो काम करता नहीं है, तो हम इसमें मीडियन पे काम करते हैं. सो वी टेक आउट द सेंटर मोस्ट यू नो प्रोमिनेंट पॉइंट ऑफ द डेटा. सो दैट्स व्हाई वी कॉल इट अ डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन फ्री टेस्ट. एंड हियर इन दिस द टेस्ट यूजली इज आर अज्यूम्ड बाय वेरियस वेरिएबल मेजर ऑन अ डिफरेंट स्केल. इट कुड बी ऑन अ नॉमिनल स्केल, इट कुड बी ऑन एन ऑर्डिनल स्केल. Nominal scales are those which you give a number. So, are you a male, female? Yes or no? So, these are all nominal. Okay? You will find that, you know, these statistics are built around by discovering the mean, standard deviation, and, you know, this the normal distribution curve. So, various non-parametric tests, you know, you will find gets used, and we use it because sometimes statistically it just becomes very difficult to prove it, because sometimes you find the sample size is very small, or there is a very less assumptions, or data are ranked order or nominal, you know, or samples are taken from a different several population. So, there the non-parametric will come. So, you will find chi-square, Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, run test, you know. So in the run test, we have a lot of tests like X chart, R chart, P chart, S chart, U chart. Now, these are all very deep dive, which we can't do in these sessions, because that's a typical one where you get a certification on, right? Then the two sample test, again, you can use Mann-Whitney test, chi-square. You use, you know, Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, and also then you have Mac-Nemer test, you know. So these are the tests that gets used by the while doing a hypothesis testing, or when you are with the playing around with the data. Okay, are we good with this? So quickly, to just to give you an example, I have got couple of examples for you before we close the session. So there is one organization here. The problem statement was, an MNC has a linear growth model and it wants to identify the relationship between the percentage revenue growth and percentage headcount growth. ठीक है, तो revenue भी grow हो रहा है और हमारा headcount जो grow हो रहा है उसमें कितना relationship है. So the revenue and the headcount details for the past 10 years, they wanted to know. So the best solution, what they did was they worked on the correlation coefficient, which is a type of a data, and you will use the plotter, plot, scatter plot, which I just explained, which is coefficient correlation you'll work on with the R value. If you're working with the samples, if it's a row value, which is a P value, when it is the entire population, okay? The second example talks about where an HR manager identified 20 variables such as education, qualification, college, age, gender, nationality, and so on, blah, blah, blah. That means there are 20 variables that predicts the hiring effectiveness. Now he wants to identify mutually exclusive variable which affects hiring effectiveness. So here we will use factor analysis. Now, factor analysis, again, nothing you have to do. You put your data in SPSS, Minitab, or, SAP, and you will go to the, snippet of factor analysis and get the various factors of the variables, and you will get an answer to it, okay? Then the third one I'm giving you, the campus hiring team is interested in how variable entrance, such as entrance test score conducted by the company by using GPA, and which is a grade point average, and prestige of the institution and effect selection. So you will see that these variables are GPA, the prestige of this institution, and its effect on the selection. Okay? So the response variable we would like to know here. So it is again a parameter, if you can see. It's a parametric collection because you can actually find out. One is it's a grade point, you can use it. It's a prestige of institution. Again, you find there is a data which is available. There is a ranking which is available. So very easily you can use a regression model, and you want to see the correlation between two, which you will use coefficient correlation. And lastly, if I'll share, the company conducted the employee engagement survey using a questionnaire developed by the internal HR team. ठीक है, हम लोग कितने employee engagement survey करते हैं, हम लोग उससे related questionnaire भी develop करते हैं, ठीक है? Now, this questionnaire has got 15 questions. So, in statistics, we don't say questions, we say items. So, every questionnaire has an item. So, that's why we say 15 items. And you get a response which were collected from 50 different employees. Now, as a manager, we want to identify the exclusive factor of this. And again, if you will see, we will use factor analysis for this. Are we good? Yes, query question. Okay, is this all clear with everyone? Okay, if you have any query and question, please feel free to ask me. Great, thank you so much for confirming that it is clear. So now I can know, at least that clarity would have come to all of you, that how we started the journey, first understanding the analytics part, we understood the various software we can use. And then now we also talked about the HR matrix. We understood the HR scorecard, recruitment element, the L&D approach, right? So there are some predictive examples. We did a couple of case studies. So we'll try to sum it up tomorrow in the session, and then it will help you to give your exams in a very great manner, right? Great. So use your various formulas of mean which has been taught. I'm sure you would have understood the scatter diagram related to the correlation of independent. And also we understood, how to use mean, median and mode. So that was a basic of things which I thought I must tell you, because a lot of people really don't know how to use that. Superb. Great. So thank you so much. I could see that there is no question coming up and the things are clear with all of you. So look forward tomorrow. Now what we'll do is, if you have still a problem, you know, you have my credentials. You can reach out to me on an email ID, anubhavali@gmail.com, or else that's my hello number. You can get in touch with me anytime. If you want to connect with me on a social media, on Anubhavalia is there in the Google, just write. We'll get to know all my details there, right? So we look forward tomorrow, and tomorrow we'll discuss in the last sessions some other insight about the HR analytics. Great. So with that note, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Keep rocking. Keep.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lovely. Bye.
Thank you so very much. Thank you.